In the Book of Common Prayer, page 610, Psalm 22, page 610 in the prayer book. Responsively, by half verse. My God, why have you forsaken me? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. Yet you are the Holy One. Our forefathers put their trust in you. They cried out to you and were delivered. But as for me, I am a worm and no man. All who see me laugh me to scorn. He trusted in the Lord, let him deliver him. Yet you are he who took me out of the womb. I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. Be not far from me, for trouble is near. Many young bulls encircle me. They open wide their jaws at me. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My mouth is dried out like a potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. Packs of dogs close me in, and gangs of evildoers circle around me. They stare and gloat over me. Be not far away, O Lord. Save me from the sword. Save me from the lion's mouth. I will declare your name to my brethren. Praise the Lord, you that fear him. For he does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. My praise is of him in the great assembly. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. For kingship belongs to the Lord. To him alone all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship. My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn. Thank you.
Father, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing. Jesus asked his Father to forgive people who don't know what they're doing. The people who are crucifying Jesus, the Jewish authorities and the Roman procurator, Pontius Pilate, think they know exactly what they're doing. For the Jewish leaders, many members of the Sanhedrin believe their actions are pleasing God. Jesus has committed blasphemy. As for Pilate, he's simply acting in a way he feels is politically expedient. He has to deal with Jesus because he's claimed to be a king. Caiaphas, chief priest and the leading voice of the Sanhedrin, believed Jesus was guilty of blasphemy for claiming to be the Son of God. Yet surprisingly, Caiaphas's actions are fulfilling the purposes of God. After Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, you might remember, it was Caiaphas who unknowingly prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. As the members of the Sanhedrin debate the meaning of the raising of Lazarus, Caiaphas says, "You don't realize that it's better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish." John then comments, "He did not say this on his own, but as the high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one." So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Caiaphas accuses Jesus of blasphemy. What's blasphemy? Lying about God. Jesus claimed to have a special relationship with God, calling God his own Father. Jesus claimed the authority to forgive sins. Jesus proclaimed the arrival of God's kingdom. Jesus predicted that he would come again on the clouds of heaven. Caiaphas and his cronies believed Jesus was lying on all counts, and the penalty for blasphemy was death. At the time of Jesus' trial and crucifixion, the right to execute people had been taken away from the Sanhedrin by the Romans. Only Rome's representative, in this case Pilate, could execute people for capital crimes. Pilate represented Roman authority in Israel. Hence, Jesus was not only tried by the Sanhedrin, but also by Pilate. In one sense, Pilate knew exactly what he was doing, for Jesus had claimed to be a king, and there was no king but Caesar. Yet Pilate is clearly confused by this messianic tender and attempts to set him free. He knew that Jesus was innocent of the charges made against him. Jesus was no threat to Rome. Only when the Jews shout that they have no king but Caesar and continue to cry, "Crucify him," does Pilate wash his hands of the whole affair. He was already under suspicion from Tiberius, for he had supported Sejanus, commander of the Praetorian Guard, who was executed in 31 AD on charges of treason. If word got back to Tiberius that Pilate had failed to deal with a messianic pretender who claimed to be a king, he was in real trouble. So Pilate washed his hands of the whole affair. After all, what was one more crucified Jew? What did it matter? For Pilate crucified lots of Jews, 1,300 in one day. What was one more? Caiaphas didn't know what he was doing. Pilate didn't know what he was doing. And Jesus, hanging from the cross, asked that they and those who followed them so willingly be forgiven. Jesus is right. They didn't know what they were doing, for they were crucifying God incarnate, Israel's promised Messiah. Jesus was dying for the sins of Israel and the world for the sins of those living then and those living today. And as he dies, he prays that the Father would forgive us all. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Would the Father reject the prayer of his Son? Of course not. The persons of the Holy Trinity are in the business of forgiving. The Father sent the Son on the great mission of redemption and forgiveness. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus has fulfilled the will of his Father, his own will, and that of the Holy Spirit. Think of the last time you knowingly, willingly, freely sinned. Perhaps it was today. A fit of temper, unjustified impatience with the kids or spouse. Perhaps pride once again has raised its bloated head. I should get my way. I know I'm right. People never listen to me. A lustful moment rippling through your mind and heart. Maybe envy. I should have got that promotion. She doesn't deserve it. Greed? Lord, just a little bit more. I'll be safer, more secure. Just a little bit more. Every time we sin, it's as though we lose our mind. We think we'll gain something, profit from something, be comforted by something, and we end up with ashes in our mouth. Lord, help me. Lord, have mercy on me. On my bad days, I can be such a mess. I lose my mind. I don't know what I'm doing. Now picture yourself at the foot of the cross. Jesus gazes at you with great love. He gazes at me. Oh, Father, forgive him. He doesn't know what he's doing. Father, forgive her. She doesn't know what she's doing. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing.
turn to page 281 in the Book of Common Prayer. Page 281. Let us say the first anthem as you see it there responsively, your lines being those italicized. Anthem one. We glory in your cross, O Lord. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us.
Let your praise be known upon earth, your saving help among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
We come now to the second word that Jesus spoke from the cross. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Now all four Gospels paint the same crucifixion scene. There are three men, there are three crosses, and Jesus is the man in the middle. But the different Gospel writers capture different nuances of this scene. So Matthew and Mark describe the men on either side as thieves or rebels. John is more generic. He simply says two others. But it's Luke who describes them as two criminals. And it's only Luke who describes the dialogue that Jesus has with these two criminals. So Luke's crucifixion cameo is like a great painting in an art museum. And when we look at it, we see the first criminal hurling insults, the second criminal begging for mercy, and Jesus saying, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Now, I believe that Luke recorded this moment of salvation because he realized it captured the essence of the gospel. And the essence of the gospel is when a sinner turns to Jesus in faith. At that moment, they receive salvation and eternal life. And the takeaway for us today is that because of what happened on the cross, Jesus offers us that same gift of salvation and eternal life, no matter how far we've strayed, when we turn to him in faith today. Now, if you've ever been to an art museum, you know that there's different ways to approach the task of seeing the art. One way is to walk through an art museum quickly. I tend to do that, to see every picture as fast as I can. The other way is to sit on the bench. You know, there's always students who really appreciate fine art. Sit on the bench and look at the details and reflect. Well, because it's Good Friday, we're going to sit on the bench and we're going to reflect deeply on some of the details that we see in this cameo that Luke gives us. And to help us with that, I'm going to briefly read the short passage, the verses where this second word comes from. And you may want to close your eyes. You're on the bench in the gallery, and together we're reflecting on this cameo of salvation that Luke gives us. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we were getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. So let's reflect on a few of the details in this cameo. First, let's think about the criminals. Now, the first criminal has what we'd say is the expected reaction. He's suffering, he's in pain, he's dying, and what does he do? He lashes out in anger at everyone around him. Have you ever felt that way? Think about the second criminal. He has the unexpected reaction. He's also suffering, in pain, dying. But notice what he did. First, he admits his guilt. We are getting what our deeds deserve. He addresses Jesus by name. How would a criminal have known who Jesus is? He understood the kingdom in a way that not even Jesus' disciples had yet come to realize. He knew that it wasn't a military kingdom. He knew it was a kingdom of a different world, of another world. And finally, he turns to Jesus and asks for mercy. That's what it means to believe in Jesus. That's what it means to be born again. And it's so interesting and amazing that it's a criminal, the second criminal, who understands the good news better than anyone else in the Gospels. And why would that be? Well, let me give you an example. For many years, I was part of a prison ministry, and I had the opportunity to go into prisons all around the country. And I remember one time going into a maximum security prison, and we were in there for a communion service. And it wasn't like a communion service that you would experience here at the Church of the Good Samaritan. It was a dingy multi-purpose room with about 100 men, muscular, tough men, who had made big mistakes in life. They were also men who didn't have an opportunity to take a shower as often as you and I do. There was no liturgy. A guy stood up in the front and said a few words, but the main focus of the service was we just sang the old gospel tune over and over again at the cross. And there we were, outside, free world people, and guys who may never get out, together, singing the words of that song. And I remember we clapped and sang and clapped and sang. At the cross, where I first saw the light, all the burdens of my heart rolled away. And as we kept singing, whenever you felt like you were ready, you stood up and you walked to the front and you grabbed a piece of the rough prison-baked bread and you pulled it off. And there was a bowl, a metal prison bowl of grape juice, and you dunked it in, and you took communion. And an inmate was there saying, thank you, brother, thank you, brother. Wherever we were from in life, we were one at the foot of the cross. And what was so powerful to me at that moment was all of us together, we knew that our only hope was Jesus. And that's true. Whether you're locked up in a maximum security prison or you live in a beautiful place like Paoli, Pennsylvania. And that's why I believe Luke captured this moment of salvation for us to read. So let me give you a Good Friday question to ponder today. Which criminal are you? Are you angry at life and it's all unfair? Or do you humbly turn to Jesus in faith with a heart that says, remember me, remember me? Well, now let's focus on the main part of this story. It's not the detail, it is the focus, and that is Jesus. It's interesting that he doesn't even respond to the first criminal. You might forgive him or expect him to say, will you just be quiet? Knock it off. He doesn't even waste a breath on the first criminal. He focuses all his attention on the second criminal. And why is that? Because throughout the Gospels, we see over and over again that Jesus responds to faith. He looks for faith. He loves faith. That's what he wants, however weak it may be. And it's to that weak expression, that dying expression of faith, that Jesus says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Paradise is a word that means an enclosed park or garden. It's the same word used in the Old Testament for the Garden of Eden. And here it means a resting place of the redeemed before final judgment. Today, he says, immediately, as people who have put our faith and trust in Jesus, we know that when we close our eyes in death, we open our eyes to eternal life. And finally, the phrase, the two words, "with me," I believe those are the two most important words in this statement that Jesus makes. Often when we think of heaven, we think in earthly terms, my favorite chair, a cup of coffee the way I like it, with music, just the right tune that I want to hear. And it's no wonder that we think that way, but the thing that Jesus tells us is the most important thing is that we will be with him, with Jesus forever. So one more Good Friday question. Are you longing to be with Jesus? You know, I take a walk every day, almost every day. Nothing special, but I come to a high point near the high school. I look out over this little valley and there's a Wawa and a shopping center and a housing development and cars scurrying back and forth, the stuff of life. But I look up to the horizon and I often imagine, what will it be like that one day when Jesus descends from the clouds? It really will happen. I try to use my imagination and say, what will it be like, Lord Jesus, to be with you forever? So as we conclude our meditation on Luke's masterpiece, we realize that in the midst of the injustice, the brutality, the pain of the cross, Jesus is offering a certain word of hope to all who turn to him in faith. Truly, I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise. Amen.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. From John's Gospel, "Woman, behold thy son. Son, behold thy mother." It won't come as news to many of you that my mother is Japanese. Born and raised by her mother, Kura, and father, Yoshiharu Tamaoki, in the Kyome district of the Chuo section of Nishiku, the west ward of Yokohama. Every time I see my mother, I look her in the eyes and greet her by saying, "Okasan, genki." And she says, every time, "Genki desu," which is Japanese shorthand for saying, "My heart is happy, for you are with me." It's the kind of endearing exchange we want to imagine Jesus had with his mother. Whether he did, we can only speculate, because the Gospels never record anything remotely like it. Much as we wish they had. We know what kind of woman the Blessed Mother was by the way she responded to the Archangel Gabriel's announcement that the Holy Spirit would come upon her and she would bear a son and call him Jesus. "Be it unto me according to thy word," she said, setting the clearest example of what discipleship looks like. Mary taught Jesus what getting involved with God looked like. She taught him to speak. She taught him to read. She taught him to write, to think, to pray. Yet what tender experiences Mary had raising Jesus, we can only guess at. The Gospels tell us next to nothing about Jesus's childhood. They give us but one snapshot from that time in his life, and it isn't of the Blessed Mother walking Rugrat Jesus and his lunchbox into the kindergarten on the first day of school. It's the story of how Mary and Joseph once left Jerusalem so preoccupied with something else, no doubt with their younger children, that they'd traveled some distance before realizing that Jesus, now about age 12, wasn't with them. When they went back, when they turned the station wagon around and went back to fetch the adolescent boy, they found him at the temple. "Behold," she said, "thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing." And as a reader, you get the sense that it was her fate to seek him sorrowing ever afterwards. She sorrowed because, following his own counsel, he left both mother and father in order to move to contact, to engage in that deliberate combat stupendous, where he would take Satan's greatest weapon, death, absorb that blow, and turn it around to run him through with it. She sorrowed because it would appear that if anybody would have cause to love him more for himself than for the divine will that he was born to undertake and accomplish, she would. Sorrowed because there is reason at least to suspect that, like the others who were closest to him, she only partly understood what he was about and may have been one of those who, seeing the great danger he was putting himself in, tried once to draw him away, saying, "He is beside himself." When you consider the way Jesus spoke to her, you can better understand why Mary is called the Mater Dolorosa, the Mother of Sorrows. The words that he spoke to her might not have been as harsh in Aramaic as they sound in English, but it's hard to believe they did not cause her a great measure of sorrow. "Woman, what have I to do with thee?" When she came to him at Cana about the wine, "Woman, what have I to do with thee?" "Who is my mother?" when he was told that she was outside waiting for him. Do you remember that? "Who is my mother?" when he was told that she was outside waiting for him. "Whosoever shall do the will of my Father, which is in heaven, the same is my mother." Sentimentalists as we are, we would have it otherwise. We would search in vain, however, for some word of particular tenderness, just one word of tenderness, some gesture of personal concern for the one who bore and fed him, nursed him at her breast, and with Blessed Joseph protected him. But we find in the New Testament no okasan genki anywhere. It's as if the gospel writers were concerned that whatever special love Jesus had in his heart for his mother, it was a love he deliberately kept at bay. Because of the mission he came to accomplish. Perhaps he felt he could not belong truly to any unless he belonged equally to all. I don't know. They were all his mothers and brothers and sisters, and nowhere in the gospel narrative does he offer her any more, if never any less, than he offered everyone else? Nowhere, that is, except here. Here, at the very end, when he looked down at her from his torture. Even here, he did not call her his mother, only Gune, as in gynecologist, only Gune, woman. And there is no leave-taking to break her heart or ours. But it is as if here he looked upon her with the tenderness that he had so long veiled. As if here at the last he spoke to the aching need that he must have always sensed in the woman who knew him as her child. Here, at the last, he looks for and finds the mother who loved him as a mother loves her son, not for the work he is doing. No matter how important, but because he is her son. Woman, behold thy son, he said, indicating John, the beloved disciple, and then to the disciple, behold thy mother, bequeathing to Mary the son he had had no way of being, so many lost sheep, and the weight of the world, its fate and destiny, resting squarely on his shoulders. Jesus' words to his mother announce that he came to establish a kingdom in which what is crucial is not blood ties, what family you're born into, what pedigree. What's crucial to who we are is not our family tree, but a relationship to the one found in the shade of a different tree, the one to be found there in that shade. The tree Mary is standing beneath, looking up at her son. Her heart, not happy at all. Her eyes, awash in tears. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things, even the earth, the water, the sky, are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
We turn now to Mark's gospel for Jesus' words. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? 2 weeks ago, we were on a small island surrounded by a portion of the most beautiful water in the whole world, living and soothing shades of blue and green. The water invited us in to be refreshed, to be replenished. The water was mesmerizing, as it always is for me, life-giving with fish swimming freely and without a sound beneath. I was one with the water, tranquil, floating with a subtle movement, oblivious of the cares of the world and even to those few strangers that were around us. This Friday is far different. Let us go back on this day of sorrows and picture the happenings in Jerusalem. It is dark and it's dreary, even in the daytime. Cries are coming from the narrow street, and they're nerve-wracking, and they're hateful. Non-stop, they echo back and forth. They hurl insults, taunting the one who was forced to carry the 200-pound-plus, roughly hewn cross on his beaten, lacerated shoulders. He does not reply in the offense. Defenseless, he is driven to complete his journey. The sky is growing black, and the feeling of oppression is everywhere. Where can one go? There's no place to hide. No escape from the crime being committed, the torture, the unbelievable, inhumane scandal taking place before our eyes. The man continued on up the hill, staggering under the weight of the rough wood, falling, getting up, receiving a bit of help from another who was told to assist him. Finally, reaching the end of the painful journey, comes even more brutality. Being nailed through his flesh, on his cross. His arms are stretched out like he is embracing everyone there, and the whole world too. Is that his mission? To embrace the world with himself, with his passion of love for all? People stare and continue their loud, terrible cries against him. Yet the man hangs with no expectation. No, not even a desire to be brought down into freedom, because he is condemned. And for the sake of his Father and for all who are wanting in real life, he willingly pays the price for them, for all. Lost in the darkness that is midday, there is finally a piercing, painful cry of despair from the man God. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, he cries in Aramaic, the language of his people. He is speaking words of scripture, those of the psalmist who said the same thing. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Had the intimacy, the oneness with his Father left him? No. In Jesus' suffering, as in the faithful psalmist's suffering, God is present. God is present with the afflicted, the dying. Jesus' cry from the cross is more than a cry of abandonment of his Father who shares in human affliction, yes, with those who are dying. Jesus entrusted his life to his Father, was now totally dependent on his Father, even in this great, horrific suffering and humiliation on behalf of others. Nothing would ever separate Jesus from his Father. Nothing separates God from God's children in their affliction. Was this then the part of the plan that the Holy Son, man, God, be wrapped up in the curse that was befitting sinful humankind? That he take upon himself all the afflictions of the world, all the rejections, all the hurts, all the outcasts, and each of us, and every bit of wretchedness, failure, all inadequacies of humans trying to escape their entanglements in life? Yes. Yes. That was the plan. He, the perfect one, was the only one able to bear the weight of the world to save humanity. His life is what love demands. Love demands the costly weight of forgiveness. Love exchanges being indebted to being free as God's own. Jesus agreed that this was the way. Jesus gave fair warning to his disciples, his followers, his beloved friends, that this day would come. Yes, there will be another day without blackness, without great loneliness, without excruciating sadness, without being desperate and being forsaken. But Jesus and we must wait. We cannot rush Father. God's will be done on Jerusalem's soil as in heaven. The heavens respond and the earth trembles to announce the tragedy of this moment. The world shakes and the people begin to quiver. More is coming. More agony. More cries for help. I want to run away. I want to go back to the quiet, beautiful, blue-green, living waters where creation is calm, where the sun shines brightly and there is the promise of hope. I want to go back there. But first, I must wait and keep company with this man of love. Jesus' heart is breaking for you and for me. While he breaks the power of sin and death once and for all, I mustn't let him suffer alone. For me, for the world. So I kneel before the cross with his people, our family, and worship the one who died for me, who died for you, who died for us, who died for the whole wide world. They might know him and receive love from him. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
In the Gospel according to John, we read these words. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scriptures, "I thirst." A bowl full of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of the vinegar on hyssop and held it to his mouth. This is such a small detail, isn't it? Our Lord on the cross becomes thirsty. Here is a portion of his suffering that humanizes our human God, if only because it is a kind of suffering with which we are also familiar. I doubt we have ever thirsted to this degree, but we can imagine it. Can't we, if we stretch our minds to the task? In his thirst, we find further evidence of Christ's humanity, if it were evidence that we needed, and if it is evidence that he offers. I know that our modern minds love to prove things, but scripture does suggest that God is less interested in proving himself to us. Remember Jesus sighing over one more person asking for a sign. Always he offers himself, but he does not prove himself to us. Still, we do see a very human God in this thirst. As well, in the thirst of Christ, we find one more sword in his mother Mary's heart. For mothers are made to satisfy our child's thirst. One of my own babies lost a great deal of weight in his first few months because in myself I could not satisfy his hunger and his thirst. And though he recovered with formula and bottle feeding, I can still feel the pain of that experience 15 years later, if I dwell on it. Some Christians, as we heard earlier, call Mary Our Lady of Sorrows. And here is just one more particular sorrow among the many which she bore. But all this talk of thirst and our own awareness of what it is to thirst perhaps obscures a much more profound truth John is at pains to communicate. According to John's gospel, Jesus does not thirst on the cross as we do. His thirst is not proof of human weakness, or not only that, but rather it reveals his great strength. It reveals his control, even at the moment of his death. John tells us that Jesus knew all was now finished and said these words in order to fulfill the scripture, And as soon as Jesus speaks, some around him act almost as if they can't help themselves, almost as if they have been commanded by their maker. They put a sponge full of vinegar on hyssop and hold it to his mouth. Jesus speaks, and they respond. I'm reminded of the Word through whom all things were made in the beginning. Remember that John begins his gospel with this imagery. Whatever the Word spoke came into being. Let there be light, and there was light. That power is also here on the cross. For as John also tells us in his gospel, Jesus insisted that no one takes my life from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. When Jesus speaks on the cross in order to fulfill Scripture, he speaks as one with authority. He speaks as one who lays down his life for a purpose. This isn't defeat. This is his victory. In this thirst is the glory of God. Jesus' words recall Psalm 69, where we read, "They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink." And also Psalm 22, where we read, "My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death." But what does it actually mean? What does it actually mean for Scripture to be fulfilled? Is it only a sort of miraculous proof? See, he must be the Messiah, for he says and does the things our Scriptures have foretold. Yes, it is proof, but it is also more. It is also an awe-inspiring glimpse into God's master plan. The cross so easily looks like a life gone terribly awry, but because it echoes ancient scriptures so perfectly, we are assured that God has always known exactly where he was headed in the person of his Son. There are no surprises for God on Good Friday. Throughout his life, Jesus fulfills Scripture in more than a point-by-point way. He isn't merely checking off a list of discrete prophecies. Rather, the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, fulfills Scripture because he embodies Scripture. And because he, in many ways, embodies Israel's own story. So in Scripture, God says, "Out of Egypt I called my son." And this is Israel's story of rescue at the Passover. But this is also Jesus being called back from Egypt with Joseph and Mary. Israel is brought through the waters into a time of testing in the wilderness. Later, Jesus will enter the Jordan for baptism before a time of testing in the wilderness. Where Israel stumbled, Jesus stands firm. He walks the same path his child Israel was given, the path of a suffering servant, but his suffering will redeem us all. When we say that Jesus of Nazareth fulfills Scripture, we are saying that he fills it up to overflowing. Imagine that the Scriptures we call the Old Testament, imagine they form a rocky riverbed through a familiar landscape. Then Jesus comes, and suddenly that riverbed is filled and overflowing with fresh water. The riverbed is now a river. Jesus fulfills Scripture in this abundant way. Our God, as we pray regularly from Psalm 95, is a great king above all gods. The sea is his, for he made it. Our God released the floodwaters of a new creation in Noah's day. Our God parted the waters for his people and closed them up again over Pharaoh's head. Our God responded to the thirsty grumbling of the newly freed Israelites by commanding Moses to strike the rock so that water would flow. Water belongs to God, and it is His to give, always. In the Gospel of John, we read how Jesus walks on water, even the chaos waters of the sea that are no home to us become solid ground beneath Christ's feet. But when is water more than water? When is thirst more than thirst? In John's Gospel, we meet the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. Jesus asks her, though she is an outsider, perhaps even an outcast, He asks her for a drink before offering her what is His only to give, living water. Water that comes from God. Water that gives abundant life forever. A little later in the Gospel of John, Jesus identifies Himself even more closely with the living water, that living water, when He announces right there in the temple in Jerusalem, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to Me and drink. He who believes in Me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water." In this way, we can become like Jesus. We can participate. We can have communion with the abundant life of God. Today on the cross, that very same Jesus says, "I thirst." After He dies, a soldier uses his spear to pierce Jesus' side, and there is a sudden flood of blood and water. This, too, is a fulfillment of Scripture, as John so carefully reminds us. And this, too, is a filling up of Scripture. In this blood and water, we see so many things all at once. We see the water that came from the rock in the desert after Moses struck it. We see the floodwaters of a new creation and ourselves in the ark with Noah. We see the cup of salvation. We also see that the one who will quench our deepest thirst will do this by first emptying Himself. The same God who is living water for us also thirsts for us. He thirsts for us.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Almighty God, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night before he died, left us the sacrament of his body and blood. O Lord, most precious Lamb of God, most tender priest of man, who feedest thine own with the bread which cometh down from heaven, in whose hands is a cup and the wine is red. We pray thee with this food and drink, so to satisfy our hunger, that we hunger yet more, and our thirst, that it never be quenched. For thine is the power and the glory unto endless ages of ages. Amen.
We have arrived at Jesus's penultimate word. It is finished. How did we even get here? Could it have really only been just 5 short days ago when Jesus was proceeding into the city of Jerusalem in royal fashion, riding on the back of a donkey and lauded as a king? How did we get to where we are today, on the crest of a hill, 3 crosses raised heavenward, each draped with a man's body, bloodied and suffering? And unbelievably, the central figure is our beloved Jesus. The sound rings out of nails being hammered into the flesh of hands that once held ours, feet that once walked alongside us. The acrid smell of sweat mingled with blood hangs heavy in the air. The sound of mocking voices rings across the valley. Undignified, the teacher hangs naked, the mark of complete shame. Beaten to within a breath of his life, a crown of thorns presses into his flesh. Blood drips down his face, his hands, his feet. Can you see it? Can you sense the horror of it all? Now imagine that you too are on the hill of Golgotha. Perhaps you are John, or one of the women who followed Jesus closely, or one of the followers who didn't know Jesus quite so intimately, or perhaps you're just one of the onlookers there in Passover and you didn't want to miss a good show. What goes through your mind when you hear it is finished? That's it? It's over? It's hopeless? Everything that we dreamed about is all for naught? And imagine hearing these words so shortly after hearing, "I thirst." Thirst is such a human need. Perhaps it just reinforces your conviction that this was just a man with a plan, and the plan failed badly. "It is finished" reeks of finality and failure. Yet this is not what Jesus had in mind when from the cross he cried out, "Tetelestai," Greek for our three words, "It is finished." Tetelestai comes from the Greek verb teleo, meaning to bring to an end, to complete, to accomplish. It doesn't mean I failed. It means I did exactly what I set out to do. Another way of thinking of it is mission accomplished. Tetelestai is in the perfect tense in Greek, meaning that the action was completed in the past, but it continues on into the present and in the future. This was not the despairing cry of a helpless martyr. "It is finished" was Jesus's victory cry. Interestingly, tetelestai was often used in accounting terms to mean paid in full. So when a debt was fully paid off, the parchment on which the debt had been recorded was stamped tetelestai, meaning the debt had been paid in full. In declaring "it is finished," Jesus proclaims that our sin debt had been fully satisfied, completely paid by him. In ancient Greece, the word tetelestai was also used to depict a turning point when one period ended and another new period began. The cross was the great divide in human history where the old covenant ended and the new covenant began. John writes in his gospel that every Old Testament prophecy about Jesus's earthly ministry had been fulfilled. The justice of God had been fully met, our debt fully paid. One covenant was fulfilled, and the next one had begun. When the onlookers thought, "It's over," Jesus meant, "It's accomplished." Where they saw defeat, Jesus meant, "All debts have been paid." When they despaired that it was the end, Jesus said, "No, it is just the beginning." So if this was Jesus's victory cry uttered in a loud voice, then what mission had he accomplished? What had he set out to do? Well, Jesus was sent to bring about nothing less than the restoration of everything that had been lost in the garden, namely to rescue humanity from sin and death, and to restore the possibility of eternal life with God. Broadly speaking, on the cross, Christ accomplished two things: the definitive atonement for our sins and victory over the alien powers of evil and death. Concerning our atonement, Jesus was sent by the Father to save everyone who would believe in him. Jesus was not only the high priest entering behind the veil to make atonement for us, but was also the sacrifice, the substitution, and the reparation made for us. He paid the price for our redemption by paying in full the entire penalty of debt for our sin. Shockingly, Jesus also became sin for us, as we read in 2 Corinthians 5:21, that God made Christ, who had no sin, to be sin. This verse should make us tremble and then fall on our faces. Holy God became your sin and mine so he might conquer sin for us. There's nothing you have done or ever will do that falls outside the scope of Christ's atonement for you, because he became your sin and took it to hell and back to conquer it. Whatever you may have discovered about yourself as you pressed deeper inward during this Lenten season,
Be assured that his body and blood have already paid the full redemption price for you. Grace has overcome, and though your sins were like scarlet, they have become as white as snow. The rescue mission that was set in motion 33 years before, when Jesus took on flesh and became the incarnate God, has finally been worked through the warp and weft of humanity with its full glory to be unveiled at the end of the age. But if Jesus came to win only our atonement, he would have died on Yom Kippur, Atonement Day. But he died at Passover. Passover, the day marking Israel's journey into freedom. And so on this Passover, Jesus also won our freedom by claiming victory over the powers of evil and death. After Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem, he declares in John chapter 12, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world shall be cast out." Jesus assures us all throughout John's gospel that he didn't come to judge the world, but to save it. Jesus's judgment is reserved for sin, evil, and death. Because Jesus not only atoned for our sin, but also conquered evil and death, we can have confidence that God will one day set the whole world to rights. Not only have our sins been forgiven, but all of our pain and suffering, all the senseless acts of violence, all the injustice, all the systemic evil where individual culpability can't be easily identified, all of it will be redeemed in that final day. The gospel can be summed up in these three words: it is finished. Our salvation begins and ends in Jesus Christ. There is nothing we can add to it. All is grace. Now, wouldn't it be nice to close our Bibles at this point, smile sweetly, and with a knowing nod of the head, quietly accept that a simple transaction was completed on the cross? Our human minds yearn to distill the cross to a mathematical equation of beating plus crucifixion plus 3 days in the tomb equals our salvation. But too many questions remain unanswered. How can Christ have claimed the victory and the ruler of this world have been cast out, and yet we still see evidence of the enemy's hand at work all around us? It just doesn't add up. We must remember that we live in the in-between days of the already and the not yet, in the kingdom that is here right now and is still yet to come, or in the words, the language of World War II, in the sure victory of D-Day while we await the final overthrow before VE Day. We can no more understand how Jesus redeemed all things than we could explain how Jesus could proclaim "it is finished" before the resurrection. Our creed affirms that Jesus descended into hell and rose again on the third day. Was this a literal descent into hell? That domain where evil has become the reigning reality? And if so, then when did that happen? If it was after his death, how could he proclaim that the full mission was accomplished before he died? My rational mind wants answers to these and many other questions, and perhaps yours does as well. Yet my spirit reminds me that these mysteries can only be entered into by faith, and faith is not formulaic. So any attempt to explain exactly how Christ achieved spiritual victory on the cross is like asking a person who was born blind to describe color. What we do know is that because of the cross, we now have an all-access pass to the Father. But we're not granted access to understand the holy mystery of everything that happened between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. We can posit a few possibilities for the concept of Jesus' descent into hell. Either this was purely symbolic language to describe the victory Jesus accomplished on the cross, or it literally took place, perhaps between Good Friday and Easter Sunday, and is considered the first act after the resurrection of the one who conquered death. Or perhaps for a God who isn't bound by our rules of time and space, might the descent into hell have been during those three dark hours when Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Whatever and whenever Jesus' descent into hell was, it is certain that in going to the cross, he willingly drank the cup of God's wrath all the way to the dregs. His prayer in Gethsemane, that this cup might pass from him, was not a last-ditch effort to wiggle out of his coming fate of torture and crucifixion. When Jesus prays about letting the cup pass, he's alluding to the many images from Scripture about the cup of God's wrath. His was a plea not to be swallowed up by death as a sinner, because he was bearing our sins on the cross and enduring the wrath that was justly due to us. In this season, more than any other, we just must embrace the mystery of Christ's completed work on the cross for us. We cannot, dare not, try to explain away all that is shocking, unsettling, and mystifying during the time between Good Friday and Easter morning. Like I said, faith cannot be distilled into a formula. His declaration, "It is finished," is our invitation to soul-penetrating hope. So how are we to respond to this hope-filled, finished work of Christ? Jesus makes it abundantly clear during his last Passover meal that he shared with his disciples that our mission, like his mission, is to glorify God. To glorify God is to recognize God for who he really is and to respond accordingly. Jesus glorified the Father in his completed work of salvation on the cross. Now our ministry of glorifying the Father has begun. Jesus told his disciples how we too can glorify God by abiding in Jesus, by keeping his commands, by bearing much fruit, and by loving one another. So as we journey toward Easter and beyond, may we spur one another on to abide in Jesus and share his beautiful gospel with others as we love one another as he loved us. And may our hearts resound with the great mission accomplished of Tetelestai as we seek to glorify the Father together. Amen.
Thank you. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Sisters and brothers, what a terrifying thing it is to encounter our own death. To face death is to face the last enemy. As the Apostle Paul says, the most powerful enemy of all, against which we all are ultimately absolutely helpless. We are those who cannot keep ourselves alive, as the psalm says. We may put off death for a while with prudence and caution, good health and good medicine, but in the end, it always comes for us and it always wins. It's a terrifying thing to be so utterly, completely powerless, unable to keep ourselves alive. Our Lord Jesus knows this. He has tasted it, this helplessness. In these words, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," he faces his own death. And the gospel gives these words to us as good news. Luke says he spoke these words with a loud voice, literally a great voice, a big voice, not the kind of voice you expect to hear from a man breathing his last on a cross. Unlike the intimate words he speaks to his father at the beginning of this episode of crucifixion, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do," these words are a declaration for all to hear. No doubt, most of those who heard these words on that day would have recognized the words of Psalm 31 and would have known what comes next. "Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O God, Lord God of truth." Surely something astonishing is happening here. The crucified man, helpless in the face of his own death, is declaring that he has been redeemed by the Lord, the God of truth, and is calling him Father. He's taking the words of trust in this psalm and he's making them his own, as if he's declaring victory for all to hear. For Jesus certainly knows the words of this psalm, and he is clearly making this prayer his own. "In you, O Lord, do I trust," is how it begins. "Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Make haste to rescue me. Be my rock of refuge, a fortress of strength to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake, you lead and guide me. You take me out of the net that they have hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth." The man on the cross declares the faithfulness of the Lord, the God of truth, the one who is always true to his word. The man on the cross is helpless in the face of his own death, but he takes refuge in the Lord, the rock of refuge, the mighty fortress that is stronger than death. He puts his spirit, his last breath, his whole life in the hands of the Lord whom he calls Father. And he announces this in a great loud voice to all the passerby who have been mocking him. They have been saying he is a failure, a fraud. He ought to be ashamed. All his hopes have dried up and withered, they think. All these claims that he is King of the Jews, Messiah, Son of David, Son of God, have brought him not to a throne, but to a cross. "He's the King of Israel," they say. "Well then, let him come down from the cross and we'll believe in him." They wag their heads. "He saved others, but he can't save himself. He's just like the rest of us, helpless in the face of his own death." And it gets worse. "He trusts in God? Well then, let God rescue him. if he really wants him. And Jesus, crying out with his great loud voice, tells them it has already happened. For you have redeemed me, O Lord, O God of truth. It's hard for anyone who knows this psalm to miss the point. Jesus is declaring victory, for his Father is the Lord, the God of truth, who is always true to his word and rescues his own. Jesus has nothing to be ashamed of, for the prayer of the psalmist is his prayer. In you, O Lord, do I trust. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, deliver me. The justice of God is his faithfulness to his word, for he is the God of truth who is always true to his word. And that means that our helplessness is not the last word. For when we are powerless and defeated, God has a word to say. It is a word said to those who really are in a situation of helplessness, utter powerlessness, sheer need. So this psalm, like so many others, has a great deal to say about the reality of helplessness and need. A little further on, it goes, I am forgotten as a dead man out of mind. I have become like a broken pot. I hear the slanders of many, terror on every side, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. Jesus knew that was what the psalm he was invoking when he said, into your hands I commend my spirit. He knew that the ancient writers of the Psalms, long before he was born, had also experienced that helplessness in the face of death and shame. They knew what it was like to be taunted, mocked, declared to be a failure. They felt the sting of being accused and judged and condemned. It's all over the Psalms. Jesus knows this. It's no surprise he took the words of this psalm on his lips, and the words of the Psalms in general so frequently. In doing so, when he takes this psalm on his lips, he makes these words his own in the face of his own helplessness, his encounter with his own death, that last enemy that is too strong for us. He saved others. He can't save himself. Well, we know what that means. He must not save himself if he is to save others. Even as he prays to his Father in heaven, adding that one word, Father, to the psalm, calling upon the Almighty Father who alone can defeat death, he submits to the sheer helplessness of human death, the death he shares with us. And he declares in a great voice that all is well, that his spirit is in the hands of the God of truth, the God who is always true to his word. And then, brothers and sisters, he gives that word to us. For the words of the Psalms, with all their anguish and fear and helplessness, as well as their confidence and comfort, are God's word. And when Jesus takes them on his lips, he causes them to belong to all of us who are in Christ. They are the ancient words given to Israel, God's beloved people, and now this King of Israel gives them to us as his own words, which now belong to us as well. We recite these words, we sing them, we preach them as good news, because in making these words his own, he has made them ours also. For we are his, and his word is for us, the word of the God of truth, who always keeps his word, always true to his word. Brothers and sisters, when we face the helplessness of death, we are not alone. Our Heavenly Father has sent his own Son to be with us, to taste death for us, to give his own words to us, to pray with us, to plead with his Father for us, so that we too may pray with confidence and comfort. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. For the Lord, the God of truth, who is always true to his word, is not only Father, but Son and Holy Spirit. Because we have our life in Jesus, the Son of God, we can call this Almighty Lord Father. But Jesus, too, is the Lord, the God of truth, who is always true to his word. He is the Lord who is our shepherd, as the psalm says, who goes with us with his rod and staff to comfort and strengthen us, even when we find ourselves in the valley of the shadow of death. We don't go into that valley alone. Jesus, the good shepherd, is with us. And the Holy Spirit, too, is the Lord, the giver of life, who bears witness with our spirits that we are, together with our Lord Jesus, the children of God, his adopted brothers and sisters. When we commend our spirits to the Lord, the God of truth, we belong to this one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who alone can defeat death, and we live in the hope and confidence that creation itself will be delivered from its bondage to corruption, ruin, and death. In ourselves, we are helpless in the face of death. It is terror on every side, but our Lord Jesus has given us these ancient words of the psalm so that we may know that our spirits belong to the Spirit of God, the Lord, the God of truth, who is our Father, the God who is always true to his word. We are helpless in the face of death, but he is not. Into his hands we commend our spirits, now and evermore. Amen.
Thank you.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, hear the prayers of your people and strengthen us in Christ to do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, as you see from the bulletin, I don't have a word. Part of me thinks, like, what more can he say than to you he has said? Instead, I was asked for a title, and what I offered was an entryway into new life, because that's why we're here. We're invited to come and to ponder, to think carefully, to spend the time, to not live, at least in these 3 hours, Christianity in shorthand. Because if you were to ask probably any one of us in this room, well, what is the meaning of the cross of Christ? You'd get a shorthand answer. And it might be accurate, but it would also be incomplete. Oh, Jesus paid the penalty for my sins. Another would say, it is the highest expression of the love of God. Another would say, it is Jesus's victory over death and hell, and more. And all of them would, in fact, be right, but not dissimilar to the way that we have dealt with these words. A fragment, or as Whitney said, I liked it, Whitney, a masterpiece, but a picture in a far larger gallery. So I don't really think of the cross of Christ as only an event, although it is certainly that. Grounded in history, the man Christ Jesus came to this planet, the fullness of the Godhead bodily, bearing on his body all of the sin and shame of the world, conquering death and hell, and releasing new life for all who would call upon his name. And that happened in history and in time. It's not merely a dream. We're recalling something that actually occurred. But because we do think in shorthand and we have our sort of favorite definitions and miss the wider picture, we gather here, in fact, to hear a wider picture, knowing that even amongst us, because we're all fallible, we're all those who know in part, there is much more. There is much more than can be said. So, frankly, I think of this event called the cross of Christ like a house, like an estate into which I have been invited. And over the lintels of the great doorway into which I have been invited to enter, whosoever will may come. And whatever thing I've heard about the gospel, not knowing actually at that point that all I've heard is a fragment, I'm invited to come in, and I literally go from room to room to room to room, as if the house expands even before I get there. Because, oh, love, how deep, how broad, how high, how passing thought and fantasy that God, the Son of God, would take our mortal souls for mortal sake. We know in part, we grasp not at straws, but at, in fact, at truths. but truths that lead us to something bigger and larger than we can ever comprehend. And we, the church, for which we are praying over the course of 3 hours, bear the task, and it is not a small one. In fact, it's an impossible one. To be a body of people who would bear the fruit of this house in our lives and through us in a way that we can declare into even the deepest places of pain that exist on our planet, that there is one who has borne the pain, absorbed it into his own body, and redeemed it for all of eternity. 2 days after I was consecrated bishop, Trayvon Martin was shot in Sanford, Florida. Immediately, I had gotten a call from the rector of the Episcopal Church in Sanford to tell me what had happened. And I knew I needed to go. So I put on the purple shirt, and I got in my car, and I drove down there. There was already a gathering of clergy across the spectrum in Sanford, both racially, culturally, and denominationally, meeting in the parish hall of Holy Cross Episcopal Church to determine what it was that they were going to do. The irony was not lost on me, because the money that went to build Holy Cross Church was from a retired Confederate general. And here we were gathering to think about the soul of a community, because people were terrified that the spark had been lit that would burn Sanford. And quite frankly, Sanford deserved some of that because of their own history of systemic racism. And yet we were looking beyond that to see how God might use us to bring healing. There was a march from that meeting, that prayer, that profoundly frank conversation of people who didn't trust one another, had been trained all their lives not to trust them. These are pastors talking. And yet, in the light of what had occurred, they knew they had to band together despite their fears and their distrust. We were asked to go and assemble in front of City Hall. And so we all got up and we marched together down the main street to City Hall. And my picture was on the front page of the Orlando paper, this big. The next day, my introduction to the people of the Diocese of Central Florida. I was not embarrassed, because if I didn't believe that Jesus did not absorb the pain of an unjust, racially motivated shooting, I had no gospel at all. Because he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, not just my private and internal struggles. Because, quite frankly, the sins of the world and my own personal and internal struggles are, in fact, profoundly tied together. They cannot be separated. And even though many of us want to think about the fact that we have a kind of private circle inside of us of the sins that we wish weren't there, all of them are reflected in the horrific events, as well as the beauty and joy of life that in fact surrounds us. Which is why even in the last hymn, we could sing, I crucified thee. So we go from here, beloved, with a calling. Calling to think more deeply, not just in these 3 hours, but in what it means to walk as biblically faithful Christians. What does it mean to be followers of Jesus? To find a way to get past the theological shorthand that truncates our thinking, particularly when that forces our thinking into the wedges of the people around us, reinforcing the narrowness of the wedges, rather than seeing the God who literally loves the entire world and who died on the cross. What does the prayer book say? So that everyone might come within the reach of his saving embrace. So that no matter who we are, every tribe, tongue, language, people, and nation are invited to come and gather at the foot of the cross, forgive one another from the history that we all bear in some sense or another, look at one another in the eye, even if our eyes are different, and call one another sister and brother in Jesus as a witness to the world that our divisions don't have to be this way. Even though we live in a climate where everyone seems to want to take advantage of the divisions for the sake of their own power, God have mercy upon us. We need Jesus more than ever. More than ever. It is possible for us to keep within the narrow vein of understanding of sin as my offenses. Do my best to try to live a good and faithful life by loving the people closest to me, keeping the family close, telling them often that you love them, being generous with your time, caring, as it were, for your patch in the garden, and knowing that anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved, and that you who have been faithful in the little that you've been given will be welcomed into the arms of your Father. But I want to say to you, as someone who has been given apostolic responsibility to bring the gospel to the world, I pray that there are men and women amongst us who will see the venue as larger than their own patch, not to the neglect of their own patch, but to fulfill the mandate of Jesus, that it is, as Phil said, complete. It is done. It is accomplished. The doorway of eternal life has been opened. All has, in fact, been forgiven. The worst that Satan then can offer us has been defeated. The curses of this life, even wielded by the most gifted people in the darkest of arts, is nothing in comparison to the resurrection power that we see in Jesus. And that's the power that he has placed within you and me, because you and I have been invited to enter into a house and know that that is our home. Our place of safety, not from the trauma of the world, but in fact, the empowerment that allows us to enter in to even in the worst traumas of the world and know that even there, Jesus is victor. So, beloved, do not leave and say, "Well, that's that. I wonder what we're going to have for dinner on Easter Sunday." Although I bless all the cooks, let me tell you. But more importantly, that God might use this event, as well as the rest of this weekend, to change your life, to open the doors to the winds of God that could take us any place that he chooses. A heart far wider than anything that we could have ever imagined, born out of a love that will not let us go, even in the face of the jaws of death. So that the joy that we celebrate on Sunday will not just be the ringing hallelujah that the liturgy tells us to say, but instead will become a kind of new fire that God has placed in us to be a people of the resurrection and to know that it all has, in fact, been accomplished, and that this house called the cross of Christ is that which God has prepared for us until we enter into the fullness of his kingdom and glory. In the cross of Christ, I glory far beyond the wrecks of time. All the light of sacred story, every single bit of it, gathers around its head sublime. This is the gate of heaven, beloved. This is the place where we see Jesus as he is, and where we see that he sees us in all of our difficulty, our ambivalence. I was thinking about Chris talking about the two thieves, Chris Hall. You know what? I'm both of those thieves, not just one. I have good days and I have bad days. There's sometimes I want to follow Jesus, and others I just want my phone to work right. But I hope that underneath all of those conflicted emotions and those desires, both for self-preservation as well as for meaning, lies a heart that beats with the mission call of God to the world. May that be true for all of us. That, beloved, is what it means to glory. To glory in the cross of Christ. Amen.
You just hold on for a second. We're scheduled to sing "O Sacred Head, Now Wounded," 168. And I'm wondering if the choir and our organist wouldn't mind just changing it up a little. Would that be all right? All right. Well, let's do this. Let's turn to, rather than "O Sacred Head," a wonderful hymn, let's turn to page or hymn number 166. And if the choir, supported by Gary, could sing that first, would you stand up? Sing that first stanza of 166. The whole congregation, please stand. Let's have the choir sing that first stanza for us. 166, this ancient hymn, the Pange Lingua, and then we'll join you singing that through all stanzas, okay? Let's try that. I think you can do it.
Thank you.
taught his disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead. To your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen. The congregation may sit, kneel, or stand, whatever you prefer. Let us bless the Lord.